Okay, in this video, I'm going to show you how you can estimate the shifted beta geometric model. So this is basically a generalization of the two-segment model that I shared earlier. That model told this behavioral story that you're either going to get a death coin that has a probability of coming up heads of theta 1, or you're going to get this other coin that has a probability of coming up heads of theta 2. And there's some probability that you're going to get theta 1, everyone else gets theta 2. The main difference between that and the shifted beta geometric model is that the shifted beta geometric model is assuming that you're going to get some death coin that has a probability of coming up heads that's coming from a beta distribution, which is a flexible distribution that only allows for values between 0 and 1. So in the same way that we had described how we can kind of sample the individual level thetas for the two-segment model, we can do exactly the same thing here for the shifted beta geometric model. So again, we have different samples. Imagine that we were to think about a cohort. I'm just going to move this a little over to the right again to get out of the way of the keylogger. So imagine we were thinking about a hypothetical set of 5,000 customers, just like before. So here we have our 5,000 customers. Okay. Now for each of these customers, again, I'm assuming that their theta is a random draw from a beta distribution. How do you sample from a beta distribution? You do this, equals beta dot inv and alpha, and you have beta. I'm calling them gamma and delta for reasons that will be clear when we move to the BGBB model, but that's a story for another day. So what this is saying is I'm going to randomly sample from a beta distribution with parameters 0.5 and 0.5. And I'm going to do that for every one of my customers. Now, if I were to look at a histogram like I did before of the thetas, it would look like this. Maybe it's going to be easier for me to just do this just on the thetas. Just format the axis. Imagine getting about 20 bins over here. So we can see this is the distribution of the individual level death coins across these 5,000 hypothetical people within this cohort. So that's what we get when gamma and delta are both 0.5. If we chose values of 5 and 5, we can see that, again, the average theta is about 0.5, but it's much more pointed. You know, the distribution, it looks much more like a normal distribution. So basically, you know, I won't be spending a whole lot of time on this, but we can see whenever gamma and delta are equal to one another, the average theta is the same, but the heterogeneity across the customer base is going to be larger the smaller gamma and delta get. Now, just like before, we get the expected proportion of the cohort that's alive to my time points, 0 up to 12. This formula is the same. If I know your theta, then the expected probability that you're alive is just 1 minus theta to the power of t. Just going to get that for everybody. And just like before, already get the kind of cohort level retention curve per customer, all I need to do is kind of get the overall average across these samples. Time. Let's see if this person got a theta of exactly one. So we know that in period one, you have to be alive. So I'm just going to hard code that as 100. So this is the retention curve across the 5,000 samples. Now, just like with the two-segment model, again, this was what we had done with the two-segment model. We had that average across the samples like before, and then we had this closed form expression, and then we kind of looked at the comparison between the two to show that the closed form expression is the same as the average across the same a large number of samples. Well, believe it or not, we got the same thing for the sBG model. So right up over here, I put the formula in. Now, it looks a little complicated. Happy to go through the math, but that would be a topic for another video. So I'm just going to take this formula and park it down over here. But the first thing I wanted to do before I did that was to show you that essentially all this formula is a function of gamma and delta, just like before, and the time period that we're in. So I'm just going to nab these values. I'm going to cut them, paste them down over here. So again, this is the closed form expression. And now when I just highlight all of this, when I compare these two, once again, I see they're just about the same. So this is the expected retention curve, sampled versus using closed form expression. Again, the closed form expression, the main benefit of having a closed form expression is just way easier computationally and numerically to use than to sample individual level thetas and then take an average. So I'm just going to use this same formula and I'm going to use it to estimate the sBG. So just like before, I'm assuming that I only get to see data over the first 7 periods. This allows me to compute the actual proportion of the cohort that's alive. Now, the expected proportion of the cohort that's alive is using that same formula that I showed on that previous tab. It's just a function of gamma, delta, and the month that we're in. So I'm just going to copy and paste this formula down. And then I'm going to compute the squared error. And just like before, it's the difference between expected and actual squared. And then I'm going to sum it. So then, just like before, go to solver. I want to minimize this by changing gamma and delta. Only constraints are I want these two to be strictly positive. So I'm just going to put that. Very good fit. Let's see how we do in the holdout period. So I'm going to grab the holdout period data, put that over here, convert that into the actual proportion of the cohort that's alive. I'm going to extend my prediction under my model to the holdout periods as well. And then I'm just going to look at expected versus actual. Pretty nice. Pretty nice. So again, this is